Welcome back from that break. You're still watching Urban Today. My name is Lynn Komjisha, and you can join our conversations on Facebook, Urban Television, or Lynn Komjisha. You can also go to Twitter at Urban TV Uganda, as well as at Lynn UG3 or at Mubarak UG. Let us know what your questions or comments are. Right at this particular moment, we are getting into something that most of you have had around. World over, the World Health Organization has mentioned several times that non-communicable diseases and COVID-19 pose a great risk to those suffering from them. Now, non-communicable diseases, as we shall see later, you will notice that these are diseases that have been around us, diseases that our family members, have to deal with. But with the pandemic, it has been really, really, really bad on them. Now, also deaths, recorded worldwide have been connected to non-communicable diseases. And we're still wondering, what is there? What is the correlation? What is the relationship? How do they connect non-communicable diseases and COVID-19? Now, we're also looking at the fact that people suffering from non-communicable diseases have had issues accessing health services during this time, because everyone is focusing on COVID-19 and they're forgetting that people out there have other diseases that have been here. Well, so we sat down. We came up with somebody to come here and explain some of these things. Now, the person joining us is an expert on these things. He is the program manager, Uganda Non-Communicable Diseases Alliance, and that is none other than Christopher Kwizela. And we're here to talk about those non-communicable diseases. I'm sure most of you are wondering what those diseases are. Mr. Kwizela, welcome to the show and a very good morning.
Thank you, Lynn.
So we are making lots of noise about non-communicable diseases. Which ones are these?
Non-communicable diseases are sometimes referred to as chronic diseases, mm-hmm. or diseases of lifestyle, or basically they include cancer, mm-hmm. cancers.
Yes,
there
all
are quite
cancers.
A number of cancers.
Yes.
Then diabetes. Commonly known as sukari in
yes.
the local language,
mm-hmm.
and then heart diseases, that's hypertension,
mm-hmm.
strokes, then also chronic respiratory diseases. Maybe a simple example would be asthma and other diseases that affect the breathing system,
okay.
or the respiratory system.
Okay.
Chronic. And then there are others that probably wouldn't call them lifestyle diseases, but also non-communicable.
Mm.
We could be talking about this like sickle cell, of course, so albino, because albino is one of the types of cancers that we should be looking at.
Okay.
So those are just a few examples.
Mm.
I will use those ones because they are the most common ones, and they are cause a bigger problem.
Well, while I was reading on them, I noticed that they said these non-communicable diseases are often not caused by infectious agents, but due to a combination of genetic, physiological, environmental, and behavior factors.
Yes.
This is where style comes in.
Yeah, that's why we call them lifestyle diseases.
Okay.
And they have no known cause,
mm-hmm.
but there are some of the risk factors which you normally refer to as modifiable
okay.
risk factors. Modifiable in the sense that once you change your lifestyle, then the chances of picking or getting a certain non-communicable disease would also reduce,
mm-hmm.
depending on the change. If you reduce on the lifestyle, then you reduce the chances.
Mm.
And what lifestyle are we talking about, or risk factors? One of them is use of tobacco products, smoking of cigarettes,
right.
and other products of tobacco, shisha, and the rest.
Mm.
Smoking, we're talking about both primary and secondary. The smoker, or
and
the people that live within
yes, yes.
the environment where the smoker does his smoking.
Mm.
And then we're also talking about things like excess use of alcohol. And that one also is a risk factor, modifiable. And then we are talking about physical inactivity, lack of exercise, or lack of using your body. And then we're also talking about unhealthy diets, exposing your body or eating foods that are rich in bad fat, or these processed sugary products.
Yes.
All those are risk modifiable risk factors. Of course, of late, the other risk factor we are looking at is absence of regular and periodic testing or screening for non-communicable diseases. Mm-hmm. We look at regular and periodic screening for non-communicable diseases in the sense that some of these diseases, like I said, you did give us the statistics. In Uganda, the non-communicable diseases are responsible for up to 39% when we include the accidents and injuries. But the pure non-communicable diseases are up to 33% of all deaths.
Of all deaths.
So you can imagine that's high.
Mm.
And the leading cause of these non-communicable diseases are cardiovascular, heart diseases, and strokes. So in the survey that was, the STEP survey that was done, funded by WHO, discovered that close to a quarter of all adult Ugandans live with raised blood pressure. Their blood pressure is high. And about 80% of people who have high blood pressure, high blood pressure or elevated blood pressure do not know that their blood pressure is high.
Oh, why don't they know?
I mean, no, but they haven't gone to have themselves checked.
Talking about having people checked, here we see non-communicable diseases kill 41 million people each year.
In the
and
world.
You mentioned that in Uganda, they are responsible for about 39%
yes.
of deaths
yes.
in the country.
Mm.
We are looking at a pandemic that seems to have brought our attention, well, albeit not so much, we are delving so much on the pandemic, but it seems to be, they are related.
Sure, they are.
How do they come in? How does the, do they and COVID-19 relate?
WHO has established that people living with non-communicable diseases have a lowered immunity,
yes.
or their immunity is low. So in that sense, they are more vulnerable to getting infected by COVID-19 or by a novel coronavirus. If they got into contact with the virus, the chances that they will escape it are so slim.
Mm.
And once they are affected or they are infected by the virus, now their chances are high to progress or to regress into severe disease, because of their compromised or their lowered immunity.
Yes.
So that's how they are related. Now, the other challenge has been in measures to curb the spread of COVID-19 that has left the entire healthcare system focusing on fighting COVID-19,
yes, yes.
including the entire systems within the country, the lockdowns. All these have compromised access to services.
Mm.
And I will say this, that people living with non-communicable diseases are second to health workers in depending to the healthcare system.
Before we go to the health services bit, what's the case for Uganda right now in regard to non-communicable disease and COVID-19? Have we seen any cases of say so-and-so has diabetes and has COVID-19 and this is how we're managing? Have we seen any of those?
We haven't done a lot of statistics, but
yes.
we can still talk of hearsay. Currently we stand at 5 deaths, and now we are close to 1,200 confirmed cases, around 1,195 The last time I think I looked at the numbers yesterday
yes.
from the media. And when you look at that, apart from maybe two, the fifth one I haven't known, and maybe the probably the third, but the other three were living with chronic conditions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they had the chronic conditions. So they had underlying conditions. The second death was, of course, even of advanced age.
Mm.
So non-communicable diseases and advanced age make people more prone to COVID-19.
Okay. There's a challenge, a worldwide challenge, that people living with non-communicable diseases are facing in this current situation, and that is access to health services. What are some of these issues that they're facing, and why have we, have governments or health facilities focused their attention on COVID and forgotten that they have people living with non-communicable diseases?
It's when COVID-19 struck, I must say that's when you hear of novel coronavirus.
Yes.
The novel means new.
Yes.
So it was new for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a firefighting.
Mm.
So everybody forgot that there was other bigger problems because they thought this was coming to finish
the world.
The world. So everybody was fighting to say, like, how do I survive this? So in the process, there was a shift, which we are now calling new normal.
Yes.
So before we get to the new normal that we are trying to adjust it to, of course, a lot happened.
Mm.
Resources, including healthcare systems,
mm-hmm.
were focused. But of course, even before, non-communicable diseases, especially in developing countries, were given less attention due to the fact that we were still hit by communicable diseases, and our healthcare system has been oriented towards fighting communicable diseases. We must agree that initially people thought non-communicable diseases or chronic diseases were diseases of the elderly and diseases of the rich.
Maybe they because they don't heal.
The affluent. Sure, when you diagnose them early, they do cure and they do heal. But when they are late, then we'll talk about palliative care, which is another subject.
True.
Palliation for another day.
Mm.
But if they are diagnosed early, they will heal. But then you said why the system, why are they not getting access to services?
Mm.
Like I said, all efforts were put on
COVID.
But also, even the measures to fight COVID caused a disruption.
Mm.
You lock down the transports. People cannot travel. That is restricted movements of populations.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning some health workers, if you are in the media, you had health workers also not accessing the facilities where their workplaces.
That's right.
And then patients, of course, couldn't access because most of our people rely on public transport. And to be precise, especially border transport, they were all outlawed at the time. And because of that, these patients regularly go to health facilities. And
yes,
the instructions that they have
is
that even when it is not, because they have routine checkup,
yes.
They have routine refills for their medicines,
yes.
But they also have times that when you feel unwell, every condition that you feel, every change in your body, if you are living with a non-communicable disease, don't take it for granted. Relate it to the condition and call your doctor or whoever is giving you care.
Mm.
Or you go to the facility and then have that one checked. So everything that you get, you develop, it's checked in line or it's managed in line with your pre-existing condition.
Mm.
Now, because of that, they couldn't seek services for their pre-existing conditions. Even any new condition they got that is likely to aggravate or complicate their existing condition was also not sought treatment for.
Mm.
And that's how they suffered the double tragedy or triple tragedy, if I may say.
Yes. Now, if I could get us some statistics here, a study of 155 member countries, the World Health Organization, found that in 3 weeks, nations had interrupted services for the treatment of hypertension, that is 53%,
yes.
Diabetes and diabetes-related complications, 49%, cancer treatment, 42%, and cardiovascular emergencies, 31%. Among the services disrupted, over half of the countries agreed that COVID-19 affected cancer screening programs.
Sure.
Now, Christopher, let us get into the nitty-gritties here. So we have people living with diabetes and hypertension, and these other non-communicable diseases. And they cannot access the refills, like you say. They cannot access their routine checks, like you say. Because I have patients, I have relatives like that. And I have seen how they've been strained. That alone, there's a money issue. During this time, access to my doctor is hard. Remember, I have to incur an extra cost, like I have been, one that I hadn't planned for. So what are you, as Uganda Non-Communicable Diseases Alliance, doing about that?
Uganda Non-Communicable Diseases Alliance is a civil society organization. We are a development organization, and we are an advocacy organization. We are not a service providing organization. We are a partner with the Ministry of Health to ensure people access preventive services or NCD services. We are an alliance of three other organizations, the Uganda Cancer Society, the Uganda Diabetes Alliance Association, the Uganda Heart Research Foundation, and of course quite a number of other organizations that work to help people with non-communicable diseases.
Right.
So our role is, one, to educate people. Our major concern is the population that doesn't know that they are at risk of non-communicable diseases. So we want to make sure that people understand the risk factors and how they can prevent non-communicable diseases by reducing on the risk factors or avoiding risk factors. We say quit smoking of all of them. Now, our other role is to ensure that the Ministry of Health puts resources, especially non-communicable diseases, or government does that. But also have to teach people to be responsible. Instead of you, because government is not going to teach you how to become physically active, to do exercise. Mm-hmm. Actually, some of the exercises are not, instead that I wake up and start running, that probably could be for me and you. Which I think is also not, I know we have a lot of work that we can do. Others, manual work.
Yes.
Like our people in the village.
Mm.
Even our people within the city who do physical work, are not going to go tell them to go jogging.
Mm.
You wouldn't want to tell these guys who carry luggages downtown, these guys who work on the building sites, to start to go jogging. So, but we also, now, so government is not going to tell you to do jogging, government is not going to tell you to stop smoking. Government is not coming to give you medicine to stop, to reduce on alcohol.
Mm.
It's just going to tell you that stop alcohol.
Right.
Now, there are these risk factors that we expose ourselves to that eventually lead to the disease, and then we start asking government
to help,
to give us drugs, anti-cancers.
I want to know, the government has a national COVID-19 task force, even at the district level. Because I've seen elsewhere some governments have incorporated non-communicable diseases committees or task force on the national task force. Is there a chance that somebody is looking out for these people?
That's where now we have a concern.
Mm.
In the guidelines that government put out, initially there was an omission. Apart from maybe routine, maybe measuring of blood pressure, not because they are concerned, but because they just wanted to measure your blood pressure, like routine, maybe examination and But non-communicable diseases have been given less attention, apart from just mentioning, just like I've just mentioned when I'm here. But at all task forces, there's nobody who is specifically focusing or representing the consequences of non-communicable diseases.
And this is why I was asking you, what have you done about
that? So we have asked the Minister of Health. Minister of Health has a non-communicable diseases department that is headed by a commission, a lifestyle and I think a mental health diseases. And there's also an assistant commissioner who is responsible for non-communicable diseases.
What
lifestyle? That is the question I should be able to take to them. What are you doing?
What are they doing?
So what we have been told and what we have asked the people is that for every patient who comes to the facility who is living with non-communicable disease, they should be screened, deliberate,
screened for COVID.
For COVID. But before you even start screening them for COVID, put in measures that even when they come without COVID, let them not get infected. Because we know that the COVID-19 and any other infectious diseases are always concentrated in the healthcare system, in the healthcare facility where we seek treatment. The difference is that the healthcare facility has measures of ensuring that they are going to treat you even when you are surrounded by other infections and make sure you don't pick it. So we are saying that there should be personal protection equipment for people living with non-communicable diseases.
But Christopher, you know our health facilities. Surely, people in the villages, people who are going to trek to the nearest hospital, which hospital does not have PPE? Which hospital does not have testing kits for COVID-19? And they have, of course, non-communicable diseases. How are they supposed to manage that? And how safe are they?
Well, government is giving out free masks.
Yes.
That's to start with.
Yes. We are yet to see those masks.
Well, I have one.
Oh, you do? Of course you do.
But I didn't get it
because you have access
I didn't get access, and I didn't even actually get it in a formal way that I'm supposed to get it. I actually even missed the food.
You wanted the food?
No, I mean, they said the food was for Ugandans, and I'm a Ugandan. Now, but
right.
What I'm saying is, if this government has started by, there is a will.
Absolutely, yes.
Maybe we can talk about the capacity to reach everyone, probably at the same time. That's the challenge.
But there's a will.
There is a will by government, and has expressed the willingness. But we are looking at its capacity to be able to supply the masks. And then we are also thinking that at most health facilities, they have the temperature gun so that they can be able to screen somebody's temperature. And then I think they are also hand washing equipment. Initially they were using sanitizer, but I think
they put both.
So there is both hand sanitizers, but I would think soap and water is sufficient. Sanitizer should be for people, probably if I forget to wash, in the event that I cannot access the water so fast. And then that's what we are talking about.
So you're saying we should just manage.
If I have a mask, I can be able to wash my hands or use a sanitizer. And then somebody should be able to screen my temperature. To me, that is enough.
Enough for now.
But they're also asking
people
living with non-communicable diseases.
Yes.
One of the guidelines that we have is that they should avoid crowded
places
as much as possible. And these crowded places are talking about homes that are crowded. Maybe, of course, with children that move everywhere and then come back and they converge at home. We are also talking about public transport that's crowded. Thank God for the social distancing in public transport, but it's not still, there's no social distancing on the borders. We're also telling them to avoid probably these crowded markets, crowded shops. We're also advising them to avoid crowded health facilities. If you must go to a health facility, you must go there in an organized manner.
But Christopher, how many are going to go organized? Look, I want you to paint a picture of my old grandmother. Okay, an old grandmother who has to access to get a refill of their medicine. Organized, how?
This is what we've suggested. That one, if you're living with a an incommunicable disease, you know your doctor, you know your nurse.
Mm-hmm.
So before you go, so that means you are going to a facility on
an appointment.
On an appointment.
Okay.
So that means you the healthcare system should know the number. No, every morning they put the files together. No, these are the people we expect. So their space is prepared and organized.
Mm-hmm.
So even when you reach at the gate, because this is what we are saying.
Yes.
Even at the gate, at the entrance, that security guard who is making people, putting people into a queue, even the triage, at the triage,
should
you don't have to sit at the triage with these people who are not yet, who are seeking a diagnosis, who are coming for treatment for the first time, or who are living with other infectious diseases.
Mm.
You should be knowing where your clinic station is, or you should even be knowing where you're going to sit. And you should limit, forget about limiting it, but you should also limit the time that you're going to stay in that facility.
Mm.
Just in the case there is, the environment is having COVID, the coronavirus.
Yes.
So limit the time that you're going to stay there.
Mm-hmm.
So those are some of the
things.
And this one should be done, not by you, the patient, but by the healthcare system.
I want to know the world you live in, because things are very different down there. Well,
Wait a moment before you go to there, because before you leave that point, I live in Uganda, and I'm actually one of the proud healthcare workers who have worked from the lowest point.
Mm.
That's Health Center 1, an outreach point.
And you know how things go on.
Health Center 2, 3, 4, General Hospital, Regional Referral Hospital, National Referral Hospital. Now I'm interacting with the Minister of Health.
Mm.
So I clearly understand the healthcare system of this country.
Right.
Very well.
So I would expect you to actually give me, to know that down there it is a different story. An old woman is going to come looking for his for her diabetes medicine and she will just collapse there.
Yeah, that has happened. And of course, that's what we are telling them. Don't wait until you're going to come to a point of collapsing, because by the time you collapse, there's not going to be any more social distancing.
Sometimes they don't know.
There's not going to be any more social distancing, because people just come and lift you. Or if there's going to be a social distancing, then people are going to avoid you. And
you see?
And then you die. Because people, when, once you follow them, people think, this is now COVID. Because people start
taking off.
Taking off.
So it's really so challenging.
That's why we are here to educate our people.
Right, right.
Those who are sick, those who have not yet gotten sick.
Mm.
So what when I say the healthcare system should be able to do that, we should now reorient.
Mm-hmm. I want us to, we'll come to the reorientation bit. For now, I want the cases of access to health health services. The major challenge, we've highlighted some of them, but the major challenge is also money. Things, medicine and the related, the needed, the requirements are expensive. I have an example. I have a relative who has diabetes. They used to go to hospital and they give them their medicine. When COVID happened, the lockdown, the restrictions, they can't access this medicine because, one, it is more pricey. Transport, the medicine has gone up. Now they have to refer to pharmacies. It is not any different there, but it is a slight better option because even the pharmacy is a bit closer. Question is, how are they supposed to manage? Prices are high. Transport is high. Everything is high, and then they have COVID, and they have to also take care of themselves.
That's where we are the now a civil society organization come in.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
We know who controls the resources of this country.
Uh-huh.
Those are the politicians,
mm-hmm.
especially to precise parliament. They're in charge of the policy that is developed, I think, from the lowest level,
right?
And maybe suggested and worked on by the cabinet. And then the laws are put in place and the resources are appropriated based on the laws that are in place.
Mm.
So,
in the meantime,
it's deliberate, by the way.
Oh, really?
That these services are expensive.
Yes.
It's deliberate.
Why?
Well, why would somebody have to go to the pharmacy to buy medicines?
Because it's a better option. It's a cheaper option.
Yet government is supposed to provide the free services. Mm-hmm. That's what we're talking about. Let the services be available. Now, the issue of transport. I think when I was still working with government, there was a plan to ensure that at least everybody lives within 5 kilometer radius, the nearest health facility, which I think we have achieved to a certain percentage, which is high. And that's what we're talking about, either health center 3 or health center 4 within your vicinity. Now, whether the facility is able to give you the services that you require is another question.
Yes.
And then the other thing that you should know, in our country, health services are free to the extent that they are available.
You and I know that is questionable.
No, that's what I've told you. Mm. They are free for as long as they are available. So now the question is the availability. So that's why we're talking about access. The availability of the services. Mm. Would you access them when they are not available? So, first of all, if we are talking about the cancers, we only have one cancer facility in Uganda, which is the Uganda Cancer Institute.
Yes.
That even is supposed to take care of somebody who lives in Kotido, somebody living in Arua, and somebody living down in Chisoro.
Yes.
All those depend on the Uganda Cancer Institute. We have the Uganda Heart Institute that takes care of the same story.
Mm-hmm.
So you must be transported if you have a problem with your heart, or if you have a problem with other issues, to come to the Uganda Heart Institute. And I'm also very sure that they also don't give 100% of all services that to 100% Ugandans. So you get there, maybe they will even tell you, go and maybe do your labs outside the facility, or maybe X-ray or any other investigations.
Mm.
So that's one of the challenge that we're talking about. But what are we talking about? We are talking about prevention. What should you do before you require to come to the Uganda Cancer Institute? What should you do before you require to come to Uganda Heart Institute? Why don't we leave the Uganda Cancer Institute and Uganda Heart Institute for that percentage that is above 70,
yes,
now that are genetically predisposed,
mm-hmm.
but for those who can prevent or control their lifestyle, to postpone or prevent them from getting non-communicable diseases,
right,
should not push themselves to that level. So that's what we're talking about.
Right. Christopher, as we wind up, in Uganda, many people living with non-communicable diseases have resorted to traditional herbal medications in the management of their chronic conditions during this COVID-19 pandemic. Christopher, we are winding up, really. We have people resorting to herbal. Does herbal actually help?
We have, some institution have, an institution by a government institution that is asked to look at the herbal medicine and look at the ingredients that are in them that can maybe cure some diseases.
That's right.
And then work on it. But there are these other herbalists whose medicines or concoctions, if I may use that word, a common word that
it's
we
most
use.
Actually
but
most
when
of
I know they, for them, they will not hear it well.
Yes.
Whose, I think, active ingredients are not known by anybody.
Mm-hmm.
They are not certified by the National Drug Authority.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I wouldn't want to speak for them, but I think they should follow. There is a government policy. There's a law that they should follow.
But that clearly spells the fact that there's a gap in health services.
Of course, that's a move of desperation.
Yes, absolutely.
Because desperation, people will think, let me do this and do that. After all, I will die.
I know, right.
So let me try whatever is available.
So, Christopher, in 1 minute, as we conclude, what now?
I did talk about the orientation of the healthcare system.
Yes.
And we are saying that the government should actually make sure that in the era of COVID, I think there should be a paradigm shift so that we cannot adopt to the new normal. The new normal cannot be in either business. The new normal cannot only be in infrastructure, markets, and all that kind of thing.
Mm.
The new normal should also go to the healthcare system. That the healthcare system should be able to address square the every person who comes to the facility. If you think about COVID, think about this person who could be living with high blood pressure. This person could maybe probably be having a high risk of cancer,
yeah. Or
in any case, could be having an undiagnosed cancer. This person could be having elevated blood sugar at risk of developing diabetes or even diabetic,
mm-hmm.
though not diagnosed.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how our healthcare system should be oriented. But also saying, let's go to the online virtual.
Aha. I like that you mentioned that one. I wanted to end with it, but you brought it up pretty early. I was thinking that maybe in our next engagement, we can talk about digital solutions.
Yes.
And interventions for to be integrated in our healthcare system and the possibilities. So now that you mention it, I think we should go and do some homework on that.
Yes.
And the next time we come here, we'll probably give you maybe a digital solution, perhaps one that can, you know, work for you and your grandmother and your grandfather, your father or mother. Yes. So I'm really, really looking forward to that time. But we have noticed that non-communicable diseases continue to suffer, a blow because of COVID-19, because most health facilities have taken their attention to the pandemic. Christopher, thank you very much for your time.
Okay.
We hope to get to you soon again to discuss more on how we can manage non-communicable diseases as we also learn to live in the new normal of COVID-19. We'll take a break right now. When we return, Mubarak takes on Segwia Owolgambo.